Hi, everybody. we're going to talk about Ike. She's related to him. I'm only the biographer here, but I want to talk a little bit about something that just fascinates me about Eisenhower, and that is his personal self-control. Now, Dwight Eisenhower had a huge ego. You can't conquer Europe without having a big ego. He was supreme Allied commander. He won the greatest war in history. He was possibly the most popular person in the United States. Both parties, after World War II, wanted him to run for president. They fought over him. In fact, this is one of the most amazing Ike stories. Harry Truman, as president of the United States, said to Dwight Eisenhower, "If you run at the top of the ticket, the Democratic ticket, I will demote myself to be vice president in 1948 if you agree to run for president." I mean, think about that for a second. The president of the United States volunteering to demote himself so that he could run on the same ticket with Dwight Eisenhower. That's how powerful a public figure Dwight Eisenhower was after World War II. He was the conqueror, the triumph of the West. Of course he had a big ego, but he contained it. He controlled it. His life was very much about ego control. Now, he had a huge temper. People who worked, I mean, maybe Susan probably saw this. Well, in fact, I think she has some stories about this. Her close aides did. But the public didn't know that. If you took a poll of Americans when Eisenhower was president and said, "Do you think Ike has a big temper?" They go, "Are you kidding? That genial, warm, grandfatherly figure with a nice smile, that guy has a temper?" He had a huge temper, but he controlled it. And I think we want to get into how that all sort of happened. But I will just, I'll just tell you one sort of stage-setting anecdote to help us think about this. This is actually not an Ike story. It's a Jack Kennedy story. But it shows you the age in which Eisenhower lived and the age we may be entering again. When President Kennedy was elected in 1960, there were some ideas floating around about, well, maybe we could fight conventional wars against the Soviet Union. Maybe we didn't have to go nuclear. Maybe we didn't have to use the atom bomb against the Soviets. And there were kind of theories about this. And so the brand new President Kennedy is elected, and sure enough, in his first 6 months in office, there's a crisis over the, remember the Berlin Wall? Well, the Berlin Wall's going up, and there's a crisis. And so President Kennedy wants to, suddenly the question comes up, how do you know when to stop fighting a conventional war and when to go nuclear? How do you know when to drop the bomb? So he says this to his national security advisor, Mac Bundy, and Bundy, he's not sure either. So but he wants to stiffen the resolve of President Kennedy. So President Kennedy calls in Dean Acheson, the former Secretary of State, Cold War Secretary of State. And President Kennedy says to Dean Acheson, "How do you know when to drop the bomb, when to stop fighting a conventional war with tanks and go nuclear?" And Acheson says to President Kennedy, "Well, Mr. President, if I were you, I'd think about this for a long time, and then I wouldn't tell anyone." Now think about this. Think about this. The President of the United States in a nuclear age, when you're really having a confrontation, can't be too public about when he's going to use the bomb. Because if you telegraph it too soon or too clearly, you lose the element of surprise, you lose the sort of sense of control of the situation. Really, that decision of whether to use the bomb or not was the president's. Eisenhower understood this. In his 8 years, he never told anyone under what circumstances he would use nuclear weapons. Not even Andy Goodpaster, his closest military aide. Goodpaster said, "I never knew." Eisenhower understood that he had to hold that responsibility himself. Now, how did he do this? Remember, this is the guy who has to decide to launch the invasion of Europe. A lot of you know this story. The weather's bad. They've got a couple hundred thousand men on the southern coast of England. They have a limited window about whether to invade or not. It comes up to one guy to decide, do we go or don't we go? and they have weather forecasts in there, and there's going to be a, you know, like a 45-minute window. Hundreds of thousands of men and thousands of ships to launch the invasion of Europe. One man is lying in his bunk, smoking Camel cigarettes, trying to decide, do we go or don't we go? Now, I'm sure he prayed to God. He was religious. He didn't talk about that. I'm sure he went to his creator and tried to make communion with him. There's no record of that, but I'm pretty sure it's true. But one guy had to decide. And finally, he said something banal like, let's go. there was no big speech, although I love this detail. He wrote a little letter that said, and I'm paraphrasing here, if the landings fail, the responsibility is mine alone. And he put that letter in his pocket. The other thing he did the night before was he went out. He knew he was sending thousands of men to their deaths. So that afternoon, he drove out to where the airborne troops were getting ready to get in their planes. General Eisenhower had been told that there was going to be a 70% loss rate. 70% of these men were going to be dead in the morning. So Eisenhower wanted to look them in the eye himself. And there's the most famous photograph of Ike. It's my favorite Ike photograph. Eisenhower is standing there in his regular civilian, not his, in his dress uniform with a necktie, talking to these guys where their faces are painted black. They're paratroopers getting ready to jump. And they talk about football and farming.
Do you know what they're talking about in that particular picture?
Tell me.
Next time, look at the picture. He's got his thumb like this. And it looks like he's making a point, like, go get him or something like that. He's talking about fly fishing. he's going like this, because the tall paratrooper in the back was a guy named Wally Strobel, who lived until about 5 years ago. And he said they were talking about fly fishing.
So there you go. QED. You know, how did this guy do it? So let me ask his granddaughter, how did he do it?
Well, first of all, on the nuclear weapons question, I think you've set this conversation up beautifully, Evan, because it's really about the loneliness of power. And I can tell you on the nuclear weapons question, my mother wanted to build a bomb shelter. I mean, we had a fairly deep basement in a property that was adjacent to my grandparents' farm. And she started putting canned goods down there, and he came over, you know, one afternoon before dinner time, and he heard about this bomb shelter. This made a huge impression on me as a kid. And he said, oh, it's a waste of time. This isn't gonna do anybody any good. I'm not gonna put one in my house. So forget it. If and when this happens, nobody's going to be saved. So that's just one thought. But actually, I think that he controlled himself extraordinarily well. As a matter of fact, many of his colleagues used to tell me the most terrifying thing was when a large vein on his neck here would sort of enlarge slightly and pulse, but he had such control that his skin, which is like mine, kind of what I call cellophane skin, you know, completely transparent, he could manage the color, but not this vein that would sort of pop pulse there. So what they were most frightened of is when he got up quietly and left the room, and then they all thought, oh my gosh, are we in trouble? But Evan, I'm sure you know this story, but I think it's deeply moving and very sweet to really understand a lot of his self-control and what he was aspiring to do. You have to read a little bit about his upbringing. He had a mother who was a very quiet, very patient, loving woman who was deeply religious, and a father who Ike admired enormously, but was kind of in the traditional sense responsible for being what Ike called chief judge and high executioner. And so they had this kind of dual parenting role. And once when Ike was about 10 years old, he was one of six surviving boys. There were seven original Eisenhower boys, but one of them died in infancy. So Ike was sharing a room with these two older brothers who got to go trick-or-treating, and it made him very, very, very angry, and he went down out into the garden and had what we would term today a meltdown. And it was a meltdown of monumental proportions. Apparently, he threw himself around in the backyard, you know, hit his head against a tree, did all kinds of, you know, a flat-out temper tantrum.
He beat his fist bloody against the tree.
Yeah. No, he was that angry. The injustice of these two older brothers going out trick-or-treating. And so I'm sure he got whooped once or twice by his father, sent up to his room. And as the afternoon was evolving into dusk, he was up there sobbing, and his gentle, kind mother came up and sat with him. He was sobbing. She was sitting there until he finally stopped. And she paraphrased the Bible by saying, he who conquereth his own soul is greater than he who taketh a city. And he continued to sob. And then she explained that he was only really hurting himself, that other people probably, you know, didn't care whether he beat his fist bloody or not, but that this was something that he would have to address in his life. And I find it moving because I think had he not learned to control his temper, he would not have taketh a city or even a continent in Europe.
Right. Hey, think of it. He did taketh the city. Berlin. The Russians took Berlin,
but he took a lot of cities.
But he learned to control his soul. And that is no mean feat. It's not a one-time thing. It's a long-term thing. He was to this end somewhat devious. This is part of ego control that interested me. Most people I know who are powerful like to be the smartest guy in the room. Right. I suffer from this. You know, anybody who walks into a room to gin yourself up, you want to be the smartest person in the room. You want to show off. Think of all the meetings you go to and there's a table of people and you want to show off and be the smartest guy in the room. I suffer from this. I think most people do. Eisenhower had an uncanny ability not to be the smartest guy in the room. In fact, at times, he would intentionally sound a little bit, not dim, but a little inarticulate. As president, he was famous for being inarticulate. And at press conferences, he would kind of ramble and he'd get his syntax all tangled up. I noticed researching my book on him that his memos were clear as a bell. They were like a really smart lawyer's memos. But he sometimes would kind of ramble because sometimes he wanted to be a little opaque. The famous example was he was going into a press conference in 1954 and we were in a confrontation with China. Actually, potentially a nuclear confrontation over the Taiwan Straits. And his aides were saying, oh, Mr. President, be careful about this question you're going to get about the Taiwan Straits. And Ike said, oh, don't worry, I'll confuse them. And he did. He intentionally, you can read the transcript of the conference, it's completely baffling. He did it on purpose. And of course, the Kremlin, they're trying to figure out what the hell is he talking about. He took some hits for this. Because the conventional wisdom of the time was that Ike's not that smart. You know, he's kind of a genial old guy, playing too much golf, really not that smart. The Kennedys brilliantly used this against him later on. You know, he's not as smart as the Kennedys. And Ike had to just kind of grin and bear it. That was not, I'm sure if JFK was sitting here alive today, asked about Ike's intelligence, he'd say he was plenty smart. I know this from personal experience. But it was useful to the Kennedys to make Ike seem a little dim. And Ike, I love this, Ike knew that history in the long run would vindicate him. And my papers eventually are going to come out.
That was his deathbed wishes, get the archives open.
And eventually, you know, a professor at Princeton named Fred Greenstein, mm-hmm. about 10 years after Ike died, gets into the papers and finds out that a lot of the stuff in there that seems so brilliant that Ike allowed other people to take credit for was actually Eisenhower's doing. He used John Foster Dulles was his mouthpiece. Now, he let Dulles be more hawkish and, in fact, encouraged him, that whole massive retaliation doctrine. Interestingly, Dulles took a lot of heat for sort of overstating the threat. Turned out Ike had written the words. When they got to the actual speech files, Ike wanted to use Dulles as kind of his front man to push it a little bit too far so that Ike could be in the background reeling it back in. It's a very subtle use of power. It takes enormous self-discipline and kind of strategic over the horizon. And we didn't know that at the time. We only knew that when we got into the archives you know, 20 years later.
But, you know, it's fascinating if you really think about this. This is exactly the same way he plays the situation during World War II. We had at that time, as you know, a deep and bonding alliance with Great Britain. It was the first time in history that there was a unified command, which means that instead of two countries running their operations by committee and coordinating, actually the chain of command was integrated. And he had to walk a very, very fine line between managing the war effort and assuring that people's national interests didn't get in the way of the war effort, and that the British were, you know, given an appropriate sense that they were critically important in this. Certainly by the time the invasion of Normandy came around, the United States was this behemoth. We had ramped up our industrial capacity to the extent that, you know, we were really in a position to be calling the shots, and actually the British weren't really that interested in crossing the channel, as that would be an understatement in good British form. They were really very much opposed to it until the very end. And so he had to meld this.
Churchill in particular.
Yes, he had to meld this group together and to make some of these other generals think a lot of things were their ideas as a way to build up the esprit to keep this alliance together. One of my favorite examples of that, by the way, is the decision at Normandy. He got the appointment in December of 1944. And he looked at the plan. It was written by a British general named Morgan, the Morgan Plan. And he looks at it, and it calls for three divisions to invade the beaches with two in reserve. He looks at this and says, "I'm not doing this. This is not going to do the job." He insisted on adding Utah Beach and using five divisions with two in reserve. That is, you know, that's a big ramp up in terms of force. So what does he do? He calls Montgomery, Field Marshal Montgomery, who was the top British general, and he said, "Monty, I can't go along with three divisions with two in reserve. We need five. Why don't you take this to London and see, you know, and convene a meeting and see if you can convince the others." So Monty goes off and he convenes this meeting and then writes his memoirs and says it was his idea. But, you know, it's okay because without those five divisions, the invasion would have never worked. And Utah Beach was absolutely critical because that is the beach that was closest to Cherbourg, which was our objective. They had to take two causeways in order to get the troops off the beach, and those causeways had to be taken by those paratroopers, and that's why losing 70% potentially of those paratroopers would have maybe doomed the entire invasion. So, you know, if someone were to ask me to write a book about one of the greatest decisions that Eisenhower ever made, it was the paratrooper decision because of the importance of Utah Beach. And if you will indulge me for one second, please. I almost wept when I read his memoirs, you know, because I knew him very well. But to read, not only did he go look the 101st Airborne Division, the 82nd Airborne Division, and the British paratroopers on their side straight in the face, but you know, General Eisenhower stood there on the airfields until the last plane had taken off. He was standing there waving them goodbye, and that he didn't leave that airfield until after midnight, and then drove 3 hours back to his headquarters and didn't even go to bed because those paratroopers were landing as the other troops were coming in on the beach.
There are all sorts of little measurements of this ego control that we take for granted. I'm just going to give you a few of them because they contrast to the modern day. If you look at photographs of admirals and generals, look at photographs of modern admirals and generals, say the chief of naval operations or chairman of the Joint Chiefs, they have so many medals that they're practically heeling over. There's not enough room on their chest for the medals. Now, look at photographs of Supreme Allied Commander Dwight Eisenhower. Maybe one little ribbon here. It's actually not just Eisenhower. Look at Admiral Nimitz, our
George
commander
Marshall.
In the Pacific. They didn't wear a lot of medals. You know what? Because they didn't need to. You'll never see a photograph of Dwight Eisenhower in a helmet because Eisenhower didn't want to pretend that he was in combat. Helmets were for combat commanders. And Eisenhower is always in a hat and a suit, and he always must, you know, there's no vainglory. There's no need to look the part, the swaggering general. Now, Eisenhower was human. He was vain. I always amused me that he designed the Eisenhower jacket. Pretty good looking, actually.
Yeah, he actually had some design flair.
He did, and it made him look good.
Mm-hmm.
So he's human, but he's careful about the signals that he sends. Mm-hmm. And modesty and self-restraint are part of the package. He had great human skills. I'm going to tell one story that I think this is Susan is an actor in this, so she can end this story. She plays a bit part, but an important part.
Yeah.
And here's the story. In 1958, Khrushchev, you remember Nikita Khrushchev, the Soviet leader. Khrushchev was a big blusterer, and he liked to bluster with rockets. It was a scary kind of blustering, you know. Remember, he famously stood up at the UN and said, "We will bury you." This is the kind of bluster that if you're living in the 1950s is pretty terrifying. So 1958, Khrushchev decides that he's going to deliver an ultimatum. The West has got to be out of Berlin in 6 months. That's it. You got six months out. Otherwise, here come the tanks. And he's very belligerent about this. And Eisenhower has to figure out what the hell to do about this. Now, Eisenhower is surrounded by military advisors and congressmen who are saying, let's send a lot of conventional forces over there. And Eisenhower says, no, we're withdrawing men. They cut our conventional force. Why? Because Eisenhower understood we weren't going to fight some little conventional war. If we had to fight, it was all or nothing. He used a poker analogy. If we're pushing all our chips in, our strategy is all the way or nothing. And his kind of aides went, whoa. Now, if you're Eisenhower, you can make this kind of calculation. But the story gets more interesting here. So our strategy is all or nothing. But we still got Khrushchev to contend with. So what does Ike do? He invites Khrushchev to the United States. And they show him, you know, they take him, he meets Marilyn Monroe, and he meets...
Who kissed him.
Who kisses him. He meets Nelson Rockefeller. They take him to a farm. This is all leading up to... Ike took Khrushchev up in a plane to show him the traffic. He wanted to see how prosperous the United States was, to see the traffic jams. And Khrushchev pretended not to be too impressed, but he asked if he could buy a Boeing 707. He wanted our technology. But in any case, the climax here is, of course, Ike invites Khrushchev up to Camp David, the presidential retreat, where they really have to work this thing out. And it goes badly. And Khrushchev is blustering, and the tanks are going to roll, and the missiles are going to fly. And Andy Goodpaster, the president's aide, writes on a piece of paper, impasse. But then Eisenhower takes a little nap, and he has an idea. And he says, you know, he calls Susan's mom, and he says, get the kids all cleaned up and have them on the porch. I guess there are three of you.
Four.
I can't remember. Get the kids cleaned up and have them on the porch.
This is a high risk strategy.
Dwight Eisenhower's son, Susan's dad, lived about a half hour away.
Oh, no, we were just down the driveway.
Just
down the driveway.
and get them cleaned up. And so then Ike takes Khrushchev to meet Susan, basically, and her siblings. Why? Because Eisenhower has grandchildren, too. Khrushchev has grandchildren, too. It works. Khrushchev softens up that night, and Khrushchev was not a nihilist. He didn't want to commit suicide. Right. Khrushchev was a survivor. He'd survived Stalin. Khrushchev had survived Stalin and Hitler. And Eisenhower had that insight that let me introduce him to my family and to my grandchildren. And sure enough, that's what turned the key. That's when Khrushchev backed off that night from the ultimatum. Now, it didn't resolve the Cold War. There were more crises to come, but...
What's sort of funny about this is, imagine, I don't know how comfortable you'd feel about deploying four kids under about 10 years old. But you should have heard the instructions we got from our parents. Stay calm. Don't get too excited, you know, this whole thing. Don't talk to, I mean, the trip was so well publicized that we were under instructions, you know, just to not to talk to reporters. We had Secret Service, so, you know, there was some help with that. But my parents were terrified that we would go blabbing about something to the press, and then that would get in there, and it would be a human interest story. Then, suddenly, and big surprise, we're called to be over at the farm. So it was really pretty hard not to be very, very excited about meeting this guy. And I remember thinking, I was about, about 8 years old. And I remember thinking, you know, this guy looks like Santa Claus without the red outfit, you know. He had a big kind of belly, and when he laughed, and he had a very teethy smile. You know, he sort of shook all over. Anyway, we get to this...
jolly old Khrushchev.
Jolly old Khrushchev. And so we get to this, out onto the front porch, and I remember vividly where everyone was sitting. But Khrushchev then, you know, begins to emote about children, and the Russians love their children because there's such pathos in that society. So... And then he starts saying to the president about, you know, arrangements for the reciprocal trip to Moscow. Now he says to the president, you must bring your grandchildren. And, you know, my brother and sisters and I are all looking enthusiastic. And my father, who is in this room, crosses his legs like this. And I knew we weren't going. Just like that. I just knew it. So after this is over, we get out to the front door. And the president and the Soviet premier were going to get onto the helicopter to go back up to Camp David. And Khrushchev dips into his pocket and pulls out four little Red Star pins. The Russians love lapel pins, but you may well remember that Red Stars were a symbol of Soviet power, and proceeds to, you know, pin them on our little dresses and, you know, my brother's little suit, and then off they disappear. The minute the helicopter's up in the sky, my mother says, give me those pins. So she threw them out, which is a terrible, sad thing. They ended up on the ash heap of history, those pins. In any case, but, you know, the gift he made to our family, which is sort of ironic, was a group of tree ornaments. For us, they were Christmas ornaments. For the Soviet Union, they were New Year's ornaments of all sorts of Russian figures. But among these tree ornaments were a series of Soviet rockets getting to the moon before the United States, Soviet submarines underneath, you know, the North Pole, that kind of thing. And those, I'm afraid, ended up with the red pins somewhere. But the others, which were perfectly beautiful ornaments of Russian culture, were on my grandparents' Christmas tree for their lives, and then they got divided up. So I have still some of the Khrushchev ornaments on my Christmas tree every year. It's a long time now. They're sort of antiques and slightly falling apart, but, you know, there's something rather wonderful. If you will indulge me for one more minute, I took Sergei Khrushchev, his son, through the Eisenhower farm, and just to show you how time sorts out a lot of things, he was wearing a pin that said, I still like Ike.
Yeah, human diplomacy matters. I mean, they are human. You have to remember that. You know, Eisenhower paid a price for this.
Yeah.
Eisenhower paid a price for this. He had been, you know, he'd been through World War II. That's enough of a career, you would think. Then he has to be president of the United States for 8 years, and there's a cost. This is the fun part of being an historian. There was an anecdote in Eisenhower's doctor kept a diary, which is great for historians, a personal daily diary, recording Ike's mood, because Ike had a major heart attack in his first term, I mean a serious heart attack, and so they were always worried about the pressure on him, and in fact, Eisenhower was sort of funny about this. The doctors were always around him, telling him not to worry too much, and Eisenhower said, what do you think this job is? because they were worried, you know, Paul have another heart attack. And in fact, he did have a stroke, and he had ellitis. I mean, he's not a young guy, and he used golf as his relaxer. He played golf 800 times as president, and he took some grief for this, for playing too much golf. And he was kind of, you know, don't bother me. I need to do this, but golf wasn't all that relaxing, actually. Like golf is, for you golfers out there, it's not all that relaxing a game. And I noticed that in the doctor's diary, one day the doctor wrote in his diary that Ike had thrown his sand wedge at the doctor and almost broke his leg, actually.
Oh, dear.
I mean, a violent outburst. And I was going, what the hell? So then I start tracing back what's happening. Eisenhower that day is trying to decide whether to do a U-2 overflight of the Soviet Union. Now, for you of you who have forgotten this, the U-2 is a spy plane, a very successful spy plane, and we flew it over the Soviet Union, and it was incredibly important because it was able to look down and measure the Soviet capacity to kill us, basically count missiles and look for missiles. And at a time when we didn't have any spies, I mean, we think of James Bond and all that. In the 1950s, we didn't have any spies in Moscow. The very first CIA station chief was caught in a honey trap by the KGB and thrown out. We had no spies, basically. We needed this spy plane to fly overhead and see what was down there. But Ike had to personally decide every flight, and the Soviets were gradually building the capacity to shoot these things down.
Right.
And of course, you may also remember that they finally did shoot one down in 1960. Remember Francis Gary Powers? One of the reasons why Susan never got to Russia was because there was no trip to Russia, because they did.
Right.
So the point is that Eisenhower, the president, is deciding every single one of these flights, weighing the odds, is one going to get shot down against the enormous intelligence need for them. So he's anxious. That's why he throws his golf club. He's a human being.
Could I add one thing, too? What year would you say that was?
59.
Yeah, okay. 59. So his doctor, who I knew very well, Howard Snyder, General Snyder, I think one of the fascinating parts of that story is how Snyder kept his job, because Snyder was the doctor in charge, was his personal physician, who, when Eisenhower has a heart attack in 1955, does pretty much nothing about it.
He misdiagnoses it.
He misdiagnoses, and I can tell you, if it weren't for my grandmother, who they were staying at my great-grandmother's house, Mamie's parents' mother's house, her mother was a widow at that time, the President of the United States and the First Lady are sharing a bathroom with Ike's mother-in-law, and they are in, you know, single beds, and his... You know, Snyder says, oh, we'll look into this in the morning, but in the meantime, we've got to keep his body temperature from dropping. And my grandmother gets into this single bed with her husband and saved his life, basically. But Snyder's under a lot of pressure for almost, you know, being, you know, not exactly on the job. So, you know, I think part of the frustration Ike always had with Snyder after that is, you know, is this guy competent? So I'm fascinated to know why he kept him on. That's number one. Number two, and this is where I really did see the little old temper flare or the frustration flare. You can imagine against the backdrop of all this pressure, these doctors did not want this man to die on their watch. And they would ask him to do terrible things, which really take all the joy out of life. For instance, after his heart attack in 1955, he was never allowed to watch the Army-Navy football game again in real time. It was like a man without a country, you know. Somebody clipped out all the news, and after the game was over, then somebody would be assigned to go in and tell him very gently who won the game. And he thought he was being toyed with, kind of. He didn't like that. So just one final note, because, you know, these doctors would come in and tell him what he could do and what he couldn't do, and he hated the sight, finally, of doctors. So I don't know if many of you realize, but Ike's last free moments were here in Southern California at El Dorado, where he got ill for the last time, was flown back to Walter Reed, and never went home or anywhere again. He spent the last year of his life in Walter Reed. So what are they doing in Walter Reed? They've got him hooked up to a blood pressure monitor the whole time. Like for 9 months, he was hooked up all the time to a blood pressure monitor because nobody wanted him to die on their watch anyway. They had noticed that Ike's blood pressure went up every time Arnold Palmer was playing golf. And so they had a conference. I know this because I met somebody on the cardiology team who said that they had a big crisis conference. Arnold Palmer was going to be playing at Augusta National or something, and should they allow the former president to be able to watch this game? And they get into a conference, and they finally decided his life was coming to an end, so I guess we're going to have to let him watch it.
But you know, it's sort of hilarious that how the doctors were doing this, but I see Pico Iyer's sitting here in this room yesterday. He gave a wonderful talk about stillness, about the need to be still. And I was thinking about this with Ike. I noticed that on a day in early November, late October, 1956, the following things are going on. The British and French have, with the Israel, have invaded Egypt and are racing towards the canal. The Soviet Union has invaded Hungary with tanks to suppress the Hungarian Revolution. Dwight Eisenhower's re-election is in about 3 or 4 days. So what is Ike doing that day? He's playing bridge. He's got his pals in there. There's a football game on. I guess this is not Army Navy. I think it was Navy Air Force.
Oh, he's probably allowed to watch that.
Yeah, you know, this is a love. But he's playing bridge. You know, LBJ would have had 5 TV sets on. You know, other presidents would have been, you know, aides running in the office all the time to brief them and update them and crisis command and all that kind of stuff. Ike is just hanging out because he knows he's got to pace himself. He knows he's got to save the big decisions for himself. He's had a lot of experience. He's been around this track a few times. He's been to war, metaphorically and literally. And he knows he's got to still himself. He's got to stay calm because he's going to be making big decisions. And he's got to watch himself.
I loved your lecture yesterday. And I just want to also say, and I say it often, that Ike made the decision to launch the invasion of Normandy in a very, very small trailer with only enough room for a cot bed. And it had a little, bathroom or latrine there. But he went into this quiet place, and everybody else was living at headquarters. He lived in this little tiny trailer. If I could just tell one more story about the doctors,
You do, but right before you do that, it just reminded me.
Uh-huh.
When he was Supreme Allied Commander, they put him into a very fancy hotel suite in London. He refused to stay there. It was too opulent. It was too gold. It was too grand.
Gold.
He wouldn't stay there. He made him move them to a smaller, more modest suite.
Yeah, well, the only point about these doctors is that's really the only time I really saw his temper flare. I had the great misfortune of ruining his golf green at Gettysburg. I was the member of the family who rode his horses, and I was pretty young. I was always assigned to ride with somebody considerably older than myself. Sometimes it was a Gettysburg College student, sometimes it was somebody else, but they always had somebody ride with me, and one day I accidentally, I think I was daydreaming, and 5 of these horses ganged up at the gate and pushed it open, and then my grandparents were on the porch, and they sat on the porch and watched these horses run all around the front of their view, and in one big sweep, all 5 of them went over the golf green that Ike had just had installed so that he could putt in the afternoon. This is in his retirement years, and I was responsible for rounding up these horses. Several of the field hands and I replaced the divots on the golf green, and then I had to go in and face the music. And as I say, not only did I ruin his golf green, but I was late for dinner. This was quite unfortunate, so... he showed no temper about that. He looked up and he said, my grandmother, of course, was catatonic, speechless. But Ike says, wow, you know what I said to your grandmother? I haven't seen horses run like that since I was a kid in Abilene, Kansas. And part of that is because he knew I was utterly devastated. I just wanted to throw in this last... So that cool as a cucumber. And by the way, the green had to be taken out the following year because the grass never recovered, the drainage didn't work, and other things. That was cool as a cucumber. But the only, really the most dramatic and moving time I saw his temper rise was in the last months of his life. And he had a medical crisis in August of 68. And we went in, we thought we were saying goodbye to him for the last time. And General Heaton, I believe, you know, he was the commander of the medical center there, Walter Reed, comes in and says, General, it's time for your family to leave. And from the depths of what we thought at that time was his deathbed, in this loud voice, he says, "How many stars do you have?" And General Heaton says, "3, sir." He says, "I've got 5. Get the hell out of this room." And we all went, wow, there was some fight in him still. He lasted another 5 months. No, he lasted until March of the following year. But this was a guy, you know, then you began to realize that that was an order. That was an order.
He was not afraid. I mean, he was a general soul in some ways, but if he had an incompetent commander, he sacked him. You know, he was not afraid of...
You know. Yeah, no, that's right.
He was not afraid of making decisions when he had to, but he didn't make unnecessary ones. He didn't get himself tangled up in trivia. He knew he had to make big decisions, and then he made them.
You know, in looking at this, I try and think sometimes what is the real takeaway from knowing this character, and then, you know, being in the workplace and trying to do my best to manage an office and. Try and advance the things I care about. And I often say, especially if I talk to a men's group, and most of my career has been entirely in a man's world, foreign policy focused on the Soviet Union and Russia, and I spent 12 years of my career on a National Academy of Sciences committee on international security and arms control, so this is a very male-dominated world, trying to think about what I took away from Granddad, and I would say, most of it was, he was tough, and he had to be tough, but he had such an extraordinarily sweet side, and he was so, he went so out of his way to create things for my grandmother. He designed jewelry, he did all kinds of things that were really quite extraordinary, and I've concluded that actually really strong men have enough confidence to be soft too. Yeah, right. I won a riding trophy. It was really my first riding trophy, and it was absolutely the dinkiest little thing you've ever seen in your life. It's a little cup, about this big. So it disappeared one day, and he presented it to me one day. He had it put on a pedestal, and the pedestal is about 3 times larger than this dinky little cup on top. And you know, all that sort of sweet thing that somebody that busy you wouldn't imagine would have time for.
We should take a question here, but my last note about he had the confidence to be humble. Think about that. He had the confidence to be humble. Yes, ma'am.
I admire your family and your grandfather.
Oh, thank you.
From a familial perspective, did he treat women and men differently in the family?
Did he treat men and women differently in the family? Well, first of all, I mentioned this the other day. He came from a boy family, and my grandmother came from a girl family. She was one of 4 girls. He was one of 7 boys. So you've got... I think he found women marvelous and mysterious. However, he loved his mother, and he loved women. I mean, he gave me a lot of encouragement, as did his brother, Milton Eisenhower. But I will say one other thing, and this is in my book, Mrs. Ike, which in leafing through it again the other day, I was sort of amazed by this. He had a wonderful, my grandparents had a wonderful couple who lived with them after World War II. Sergeant Money, who was an African-American sergeant who'd, you know, been a gardener, I think, and then was interviewed by the Supreme Allied Commander to come, actually he was a 4-star at that time, to come work at headquarters. And Sergeant Money became his valet, and Sergeant Money was with him until the end of his life, and Sergeant Money died right after Ike did, really. But, you know, this African-American couple lived there, and in it, Dolores, the wife, she did the cooking. She said that whenever she came into a room, or I should put it another way, that whenever he saw her, he took off his hat. And, you know, I think that's pretty amazing, not only to treat... your help that way, but to recognize that she said he always treated her like a lady, even though she was in the kitchen, which I think is marvelous, a big influence of her mother. I should add, by the way, that Sergeant Money was the first African-American ever to be a pallbearer at a president's funeral. And there Sergeant Money was standing next to General Norstad. And I thought that these, you know, the brass must have been really sort of shaken that an African-American sergeant was standing there as his peer, as their peer for that occasion.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Well, first of all, as a family, we're immensely proud of it. And don't get me wrong about the doctors. You know, doctors never deliver happy news when they're going in to tell somebody who's been as active as Dwight Eisenhower was his whole life that he has to curtail his, you know, his way of living. And so, you know, my father was deeply affected by that too and was very stoic all the way up until the end. My father was diagnosed with having cancer 15 years before. He refused to have it treated. I mean, I'm afraid that this kind of attitude runs in the family, but nobody respects more than my grandparents did the immense amount of skill and care they received. And I think it's absolutely marvelous that this medical center is here and it serves such an important community, not only in California, but across the nation and the world. And it's terrific, the amount of support that has come from this community. So. Don't take my stories about doctors the wrong way. It's just that nobody really did a very good job of telling him too much about what to do.
Well, Dr. Snyder was a good, he misdiagnosed his heart attack, yes, but he was a great family doctor. He understood his patient. He knew Ike. He understood their marriage. I mean, he saw what a loving relationship Ike and Mamie had. You can feel it in the diary. There's a great scene where Ike and Mamie bicker one night, and then Ike crawls into bed with Mamie at 4 o'clock in the morning, and you can just feel the tenderness of the marriage. And that was part of being a good doctor, was understanding that.
Right. That's right. Absolutely. Oh, the Eisenhower Memorial.
Yes.
Well, I'm very happy to say that we've got a resolution to the issue. The Fine Arts Commission had already approved the design, so it was very clear that this design was going to move forward. I'm really gratified because they have the consensus agreement was to change the theme of the memorial from a young boy looking at his future career. As general and president, and now to frame the Eisenhower Memorial against the backdrop of Normandy and peacetime, the beaches of Normandy and peacetime. That was a decisive moment, not only in the war, but it was a decisive moment for America's place in the post-war period. And if it hadn't been for success there, certainly he would have been reassigned. The United States might have lost its preeminent role in that coalition. And he certainly would have never been president. So I think it's an appropriate backdrop. And what I like about it, and let me just say this very quickly, is it's about others, too. It's not just about Eisenhower. It's about those young boys who went across the English Channel and the paratroopers who came down and did their duty. And by the way, the number was more like 20%, not 70.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, this is, I think, really, it'll be monumental, the narrative will be monumental in a way that's appropriate, I think, for the core of Washington.
Where is that going to be located?
It's going to be located next to the Air and Space Museum. And, you know, we're pretty far along now, and I'm just delighted that we found that that consensus because, you know, it will be not only recognition of his leadership, but a homage to all of the people who were part of that effort.
Well, we have about 30 seconds left. Little known fact, Dwight Eisenhower, once he got us out of the Korean War, which he did, never lost another American soldier in combat over the 8 years of his presidency. And he cut military spending. He cut his own service, the army, by 30% because he had no intention of using it. Thanks very much.